This morning, it's my birthday. I guess technically the whole day is my birthday. My 29th birthday for, you know, the third or fourth time. On this special occasion, I want to talk about a special topic, a topic that's definitely special to me that we don't necessarily talk that much about, especially in the conservative movement, which is spirituality. I want to talk about spirituality. Spirituality is something that it's not easy to even define. What is spirituality anyway? Well, hopefully we'll get to definitions later today, kiddish conversation to be continued. It's something that's not easy to define, but in my opinion and in my experience, spirituality is something that's important. It's actually a human need. It's definitely something important for me. And so we'll talk a little bit about spirituality. And again, like I said, I hope we continue to talk and think about spirituality, both individually and as a community, especially as we're starting to lead up to the high holidays. But don't tell anyone, that's like vastly in the future. But the high holidays are a spiritual time. So we're thinking about it. Okay. So I'd like to suggest, or at least share my understanding, that there are two different types of spirituality. Now, in our parsha this week, we also have the idea of two different types of rules. So we'll talk about both of those things. So two different types of spirituality. The first one I call, for, you know, the alliteration of it, mountaintop moments. Those are the moments of spirituality that are like, wow, experiencing a feeling of awe. I think a lot of times we experience these mountaintop moments during life cycle moments. Birth, death, marriage, these are, and even sometimes birthdays, special birthdays, we experience these feelings of awe and of wow. I remember very, very clearly a time that I experienced this when I was 17. I was with a friend in the car. We were driving across the Golden Gate Bridge. I'm from Northern California. The sky was blue. There were puffy white clouds in the air. We had a great song that we were listening to, and it was like, oh, I felt this wow throughout my whole body. I don't really have words for it, but I can still feel what that feeling was. So that's the first type of spirituality, the mountaintop moments. Now the second type, I'll have to quote my friend and colleague, Chaplain Adam Siegel, and say, this type of spirituality is doing things I don't want to do. That's his word-for-word definition for it. These are daily tasks, daily chores, even sometimes the rhythm of daily tefillah, where we pray three times a day. The practice of keeping Shabbos, even when you're busy, when you have things that you need to do, you take a day and you rest. This type of spirituality, especially in my recent experience, shows up with family, with caring for our children, caring for our elders, caring for our partners, and in having difficult conversations. This is the second type of spirituality. My friend Chaplain Adam Siegel calls it doing things I don't want to do. So these are the two types of spirituality that I'd like to suggest. And I want to parallel them to the two types of rules that are suggested and taught by our parasha. So the first type is rules that don't make, the first type is the rules that do make sense, also known as mishpatim. These rules are, for example, things like at a red light, stop your car. When you're shopping or at a restaurant, pay for your merchandise or pay for your meal before you leave. I live in a large apartment building, and one of the mishpatim of the apartment building is no smoking in the apartment building, because if someone smokes over here, you can smell it everywhere. These mishpatim, these rules that make sense, they regulate social behavior, and the benefit to society is obvious and clear. Now, suggested by our parasha Chukat, Chukim, and specifically the rule in the beginning of this week's parasha, is our classic example of rules that don't make sense. So we have this week's parasha, the rule of the red cow, the para aduma. There's a specific, long, involved process we have to do to create this water of purification. We don't do that these days because we don't have a holy temple, but we still follow some rules that don't make sense. For example, we are not allowed to wear clothing that is wool and linen woven together. That's called shatnez, not allowed in Jewish tradition. As we all are familiar with, there are a number of foods that we do not eat because they're not kosher, like pork or shrimp. We know that human beings can eat these foods and it's totally fine, but not Jews. It's different for us. We have to follow this rule that isn't logical. And these rules make us ask, what's the benefit here? Okay, so we have two types of spirituality and two types of rules. Okay, so we have the mountaintop moments, the spirituality that like, okay, I don't know if I can define it, but I'm pretty sure this is spiritual. And we have the rules that make sense. These are kind of like the things that seem to make sense. Then we have, on the other hand, the rules that don't make sense, the rules that we don't really understand why we're supposed to do it, and these moments of daily practice, these daily tasks of things that I don't want to do, but I know they're important. Okay, that type of rule and that type of spirituality. Okay, so why am I thinking about this week? Well, I had a conversation with someone in our community that brought up two different topics, and it's always such a gift to have conversations with all of you. They're so inspiring and instructive for me, so really grateful for you all. And this particular conversation this week brought up two different topics, the topic of spirituality and the topic of, you know, these things in Jewish tradition that we do them, but why do we do them? So this topic of spirituality, the topic of the reason why we do things, they were floating around in my head at the beginning of this week. And they came up when I was engaging in a spiritual practice that's been very important to me for about the last 8 years, which is Daf Yomi. I know I've talked about it many times. It's the practice of studying one page of Talmud every day. And for me, it bridges the gap between these two types of spirituality. It is a daily practice. So some days I have more motivation than others. Each daf is important. Each page of Talmud is important, just like every verse of Torah is important. But some speak to me a little bit more than others, we'll say, you know. And so no matter what, I do this every day. I find this practice very, very grounding, because sometimes life is very tumultuous, and no matter what, there's another day, another page of Talmud. It's also very humbling, because life becomes very, very busy, and I don't have time for this and that. But every day there's another page of Talmud. If I fall behind, it's on me to catch up. And also, because you never know what the Talmud is going to contain, it's got this thing where it's like, it's boring, but it's exciting. You never know what's going to happen, and so sometimes there are great surprises. And it's taught me over time that when you do the same thing every day, you start seeing in a different way how different each day can be. So this past Tuesday, the 9th of July, Bava Batra, page 14, I really encountered a big surprise. It was a daily task that I was doing that led me to a mountaintop moment. So we're going to learn this sugya that was so surprising for me, that's so delightful for me, and I hope it's delightful for you. If you haven't studied Talmud before, hold on to your seat. It's going to be an experience. Okay. So Sepharia, this sepharia.org, a website that has an amazing resource of Torah text and learning and commentary, explains that Masechet Bava Batra, Tractate Bava Batra, the tractate that I read the page of this week, is about relationships between neighbors. It's about land ownership, sales, and inheritance. Okay, so if you have studied Talmud before, you know this that's a pretty good try at explaining what this tractate is about, but each page of Talmud is so varied, it's really difficult and perhaps even impossible to say what a certain tractate is about. So that's mostly what the tractate's about. But on this page of Talmud, the topic is not that at all. It's the topic of the Ark of the Covenant, Aron HaBrit, in ancient times, that Moses made. So of course, this is totally on topic, like land ownership, Ark of the Covenant. You can see the through line. No, not at all. But that's what the Talmud is. That's one of the reasons why I delight in the Talmud so much. So we begin the sugya, we begin the section that's talking about this, and I promise it's going to end in a mountaintop moment, at least for me, hopefully for all of you. So we start talking about the size of the Ark of the Covenant. We go into lots of details about how many handbreadths is the length, the width, and the height, how many handbreadths to a cubit, all of that. Okay, so we give the opinion first of Rabbi Meir. It talks about the length, width, and height of the Ark, then the length, width, and height of the two tablets that were in the Ark. It talks about how they were arranged in the Ark. And the reason why it talks about this is it's explaining that a Torah scroll is also going to be there in the Ark, along with the tablets, a Sefer Torah written by Moses. Okay, so how do we know that the Sefer Torah was there? Well, we take this verse from the first book of Kings, and that's the answer. Okay, so because of this first book, verse from the first book of Kings, chapter 8, verse 9, for those following along in detail, we interpret it in a particular way. We use a particular principle to interpret it. And of course, that's how we know that the Sefer Torah was in the Ark. Okay. But then we start asking some questions on Rabbi Meir's opinion. What about the width again? How big is this Ark? How can the Sefer Torah fit in without being squished? Okay, we kind of resolve that. And we say that all these measurements according to Rabbi Meir. But this is the Talmud. So we don't have just one opinion. We have to have another opinion so we can argue between them. Okay, so Rabbi Yehuda comes along. He disagrees. He offers a whole new set of measurements. And he explains how there are these silver columns also in the ark, not previously mentioned. Okay, and then he adds that not only are there silver columns in the ark, there's a special chest next to the ark. And the Torah scroll was placed on top of that special chest, not in the ark at all. Then now we really have something to disagree about, right? And so it's not now the people who articulated those opinions, Rebbe Meir and Rebbe Yehuda, disagreeing. It's anonymous scholars just arguing back and forth, saying, okay, well, if Rebbe Yehuda is right and the Sefer Torah isn't in the ark, what else besides the tablets are in the ark? We got to use that extra space somehow. You might say the silver columns, but for some reason it's not that. The answer is it's the broken tablets. Not just the whole tablets that Moses wrote when Moses went up to Mount Sinai the second time, but the first set he brought back down, and of course the golden calf was made. He was very upset, and in his anger he shattered the tablets. So those shattered tablets apparently are also in the ark. Okay. So all right. So if we have the shattered tablets and the silver columns and the Torah scroll, how does it all fit inside? We have all save us some of the details, right? And then they have exact. Descriptions of how all of these things fit in, and then they take a verse. They go to a verse, Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 26, take this Torah and place it next to the ark, and they say that this is the verse that illustrates that the Sefer Torah is next to the ark and not in the ark. And that's according to Rabbi Yehuda. But Rabbi Meir says, well, you know, we can, next to the ark can actually mean in the ark, but just next to the tablets in the ark. Okay, so now let's take a quick pause so you can understand how this type of spirituality, learning Talmud every day, is like, whoa, this is quite a task. This is sort of feeling like a thing I don't want to do. It's very complicated. It's very challenging. Why am I even doing this? So we're getting there. We're getting there. Okay, so we have this this next verse, second book of Samuel, chapter 6, verse 2, and we have this verse interpreted in two different ways, one Rabbi Meir, one Rabbi Yehuda, saying that this is the verse that indicates that not only were all these physical objects in the ark, there's a spiritual object in the ark, the names of God, not only the ineffable name, the name that we can't pronounce out loud, but all God's names are in the ark. Okay. So now we have a disagreement about, is Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda, are they using the two verses, are they using the same verse in the same way or in two different ways? And now we finally get to something that's starting to make a little bit more sense. So Rabbi Meir quotes a verse from the book of Deuteronomy, the book of Devarim, which is in the five books of Moses, chapter 10, verses 1 through 2. The context here is that God is telling Moses to put both sets of tablets in the ark. Okay, this seems like, okay, if God gave the instruction, then sure, we know that what it means is there are the two sets of tablets in the ark, the whole one and the broken one. Makes sense, right? Okay, so, but again, we have this consistent thing of Rabbi Yehuda and Rabbi Meir, they can't use any verse in the same way. They always have to have different interpretations. So now we need another interpretation of what this verse could mean. It seems pretty straightforward. God's telling Moses, put the broken tablets and the whole tablets into the ark. What could it possibly mean besides that? Well, Rabbi Yehuda quotes Reish Lakish and says, the first tablets which you broke, the word is asher shibarta, the first tablets which you broke. And what this means is that when God saw that Moses had broken the two tablets, he said to him, yishar kochacha shibarta, yashar koach, that you broke the tablets. May your strength be straight. Because you broke the tablets, it was the right thing to do. And finally, yishar kochacha, yashar koach. This is where the saying comes from. We have this moment in Talmud where we're interpreting that when Moses breaks the tablets, God is saying, yes, you did the right thing, good job. And so we still say in our communities, when someone does a good job, yashar koach. So this is a whole lot of stuff to get to this mountaintop moment. So, and I'm thinking, here's this, I had this conversation with someone who was talking about spirituality, who was talking about why is it that we do these strange things we do in Jewish tradition, and I'm thinking, wow, I learned something about why we do something in Jewish tradition that I can share with the community, I can share with this person, I can talk about my experience of spirituality, this is all coming together, this is gonna be great. So, the argument that I'm making here is that we have to do these daily practices. We have to do the spiritual practices that fall under the category of things we don't want to do if we want to maximize our experience of mountaintop moments. When we do things every day, whether or not we want to do them, we make ourselves more aware. We make ourselves better at taking action. Ultimately, like I'm saying, this leads to more awareness, and more awareness leads to more mountaintop moments. These two types of spirituality support each other. So bringing it back to our parasha, what about these two types of rules that our parasha speaks about? This is my idea, this is my interpretation for this year. The chukim, the rules that don't make sense, like the red cow that we read about in the beginning of the parasha, when we follow these rules that don't make sense, it gets us to be better at following rules. We get used to the idea of there are certain foods we can't eat. We come to accept that. We follow the rule. We accept the idea that linen and wool might make fine suits, but we don't wear that. That's a no-go. We learn to be mindful about our clothes and about our food. Even this whole thing about the water of purification, we'll find the red cow, we'll make it happen. So when we get to the mishpatim, the rules that do make sense, the rules that we need to follow to support society, we're that much more willing to follow them. So the next time you stop at a red light, the next time you pay for your merchandise before you leave a store, think of the red cow, think of the para aduma. Remember how learning to do things you don't want to do, learning how to follow rules that don't necessarily make sense, it can help us experience mountaintop moments and to behave in a way that benefits humankind. Shabbat shalom.